Mama Jones and Big John Talley had a big crap game going back in the alley. And I kept rolling them seven and winning all them pots. My luck was so good I could do no wrong. I just kept on rolling and controlling them bones. Finally, they threw up their hand and said, when you hot, you hot. I said, yeah. When you hot, you hot.
You know what?
When you're not, you're not.
I'm hot, baby.
Put all the money in and let it roll.
Hey, good Tuesday afternoon to you. Thanks for listening in. I'm Tony Gullis, the Great White Capper, and you've tuned in to The Tank. Gonna talk a lot about sports, a lot of stuff going on. Get right into the big news of the day, Roger Goodell coming out finally. You know, I thought it was interesting, you know, haven't heard anything from him in a while. Then all of a sudden this morning, I hear, oh, he's going to be on Mike and Mike early. Easy, you know, here it's like 6:30 in the morning. I was up most of the night, as I am handicapping from time to time. I can definitely have my sleep schedule rearranged, looking for naps when I can afford to take them. But speaking of Goodell, I was like, interesting, you know, he's going to be on Mike and Mike. Yeah. Right behind that, I see ESPN Outside the Lines report coming out. Yeah, so right away I know, okay, he's speaking out, trying to come out ahead of that report. Interesting, the report pretty much suggesting that the NFL and pretty much Goodell, upon finding out revelations of Spygate, covered up the extent to which it went. You know, how deep it was, how many games did they film, specifics of their misconduct were never really put out there specifically for digestion. In fact, there's a part of this report from ESPN suggesting that Goodell had people destroy the tapes. All right, this is what I've coming to find out, like the information, you know, as I see it. The Patriots were filming a lot of practices, and based more specifically than the routes and the plays, they were focusing in on the hand signals of the defensive coaches. It's pretty funny, right after Spygate, I think it was mentioned on the radio, in fact I know it was mentioned, that right after this Spygate, that the NFL went to the transistors in the ear of the defensive captain so they could eliminate some of the hand signals needed by the defense. Coming right on the tail of this. So essentially what it seemed like to me, the Patriots were doing their best to understand the language of the hand signals, probably to help figure out blitzing or scheme, you know, something of that nature. If they see that hand signal on the opposing sideline, they have a better idea of what defense is coming at them. Kind of schemish and conniving, you know, pretty sharp and witty, I guess. But at the same time, it's just, it makes you not really like them, man, when they have to resort to that. Like the Panthers, I'm a huge Panthers fan from Charlotte, North Carolina, born and raised out here in Surprise, Arizona now. But my Panthers lost a excruciatingly close game to the Patriots during that stretch, right in the middle of the Spygate bullshit years, that, you know, the heyday of the Spygate. It was a, you know, losing at the buzzer on a long field goal from Adam Vinatieri. You know, we're there pushing them the entire way, even had leads going into the fourth. Maybe they were able to make the big plays and get back in the game because they knew what defenses we were going to run. It would be really sad if that was the case, you know. That would piss me off more. It's even kind of gets my blood going thinking about it. That my team got gunned down at the buzzer, at the wire, at the gun by a team basically, you know, she called it cheating, however you want to look at it. I know baseball, they do it. It's the way they did it. You know certain people are going to look at your signals. That's why you might have two or three dudes putting in signals. Any of those scenarios, I get that. But you're not expecting practices and different angles, and just you're not expecting to have total surveillance on every move you're making, especially the walkthroughs and the practices. That's not what that is tipping competitive balance. But apparently, this report, man, is pretty much saying Goodell squashed it. I guess at the time in 2007, protecting the image of the Shield and not having the scandal be as big in the public eye as it actually was at the time, they just sanctioned out. And a lot of the owners this time, because of that, this report might even suggest, the owners were basically telling Goodell, they're all 31 of them, they are his boss. You know, collectively, they tell this guy what to do. He doesn't do things without them telling. It's almost surprising he didn't lose his job for the destruction of evidence. It's just a crazy story. Well, a lot probably more as this story comes out, a lot more will be talked about it specifically. But I did find it interesting coming up right into week one. The appeal for the court case, just everything, the way it broke down, it's just very interesting that it that it's the politics and things off the field are more important than the actual games. I'll just be glad when the season starts and we really get some real games going. But for right now, I'm going to have the Doobie Brothers help me out in the background a little bit. I'm going to talk about U.S. Open Tennis. We've got more of a sporting event tonight than a gambling event. Serena, 9-1 favorite. Not something I want to really put money on. Wouldn't recommend it to anybody. But you know, if you're a tennis player, that's one thing you have to know how to do is run. And run a lot. And you wonder, a player like Serena, and even Venus. I specifically remember watching Serena Williams win her first major at the U.S. Open in 1999. She beat her sister Venus. Thinking at that time, I think she might end up being better than Venus. Who Venus at the time had a couple years out on the tour, year and a half to two, ahead of her younger sister Serena at that time. So she was the name. Venus was the one taking tennis by storm, and then her sister joined her. And they battled on. They had raging battles. For now, it's 16 years later, and here they are in the quarterfinal of the U.S. Open playing again. Both viable assets in the tennis game. And on the part of Serena, not just a viable asset, totally dominating the sport of women's tennis. You've got Serena Williams, and then you've got just a confluence of everyone else that are wannabes, not quite good enough. Once Maria Sharapova, what is she? She's lost 17 consecutive matches to Serena. Is that your competition? Someone you just beat like a drum? Show up every 6 weeks to get your fucking ass beating and go back home? I don't know. Just Serena. And realizing, you know, it's not even putting in the race card to say that these girls grew up playing tennis, living in Compton, playing on public courts. I don't even think that's just something to pile on top of the amazement of the careers they've had. I just like Serena because she's a hell of a competitor. She's grown into this. There were a few years there where I wondered if she wanted to play anymore. And it kind of that look you could tell when she played, she wasn't that interested. I don't see that look anymore, to be honest. I see a woman that wants to win, and it shows. Going for this calendar Grand Slam, she'll have to go through her sister Venus tonight. And like I say, I think it's an event. I'll be watching. I think it's something worth watching. You don't have to gamble on everything you do in life. You have to disseminate. Pick your spots. And I do the same with sports. Not everything is about gambling. Your Triple Crown horse winners, some of your golf tournaments, a story like this at the U.S. Open. Not everything is about, hey, can I get that dollar down? This is a story about tennis, a sport, a great sport, a sport I've always enjoyed. Mano y mano. They play doubles, but from my point of view, it's a thinking man sport. You need the skill and talent and abilities to go with it, but you also need to have a little something between the ears if you're going to compete on the world stage in this sport. And that's what's going on tonight. I want to thank the Doobie Brothers that keeps you running for helping me through that segment of the show talking about the U.S. Open quarterfinal match tonight. Serena, he knows another interesting thing. Serena has the edge. Yep. I know she's had the edge for a while, but there was a while, a period of time when those two would battle each other with some great matches. All-time series now. I want to make sure I get this right. I believe I got it right in my head here. Serena's 15-10. 15 wins for Serena, 10 wins for Venus. And in Grand Slam tournaments, the total is 8 for Serena, 5 for Venus. I'm not sure about Grand Slam final, of those 13 in Grand Slams, how many of those were in finals. I think Serena's has the edge in that one also. I don't know that, though. It'd be one I need to check on later. Gonna let you guys know, man, just a huge week coming up. Let you know, NFL top bet of the week. I've got it ready, man. 23 wins, 9 losses, 2 draws, 23-9-2 the last two seasons. NFL has 17 weeks. I'll have 17 top bet of the week selections for you this year. Week 1, I've got it. Got it locked in already. The rest of the card, I'm still bantering and grinding and trying to come up with the proper weights and how to grade the plays. But the top end play, I've got picked out, ready to go. You can get on the free play email list. I'm going to give you a free play in MLB tonight. I'm going to go ahead and give it to you now. The free play that I've been putting out on the social media and sent out to the people on my free play email list is Pittsburgh Pirates with Liriano pitching tonight. I gave it out on the email list and to my clients at about 111, 115. I see it's about 120 now. Still probably the right free play. I'm going to go back to Liriano again. I actually had him as a bigger play last time. I believe it was maybe the last best bet that I lost was Liriano at Milwaukee. He didn't pitch terrible, but I just remember he had to grind through several innings. It took the heat out of his cells, it took the starch out of his collar, and he folded up. Pirates fought back to get it tied at 3, but he was pretty much cooked at that point. Pirates obviously didn't feel strong enough to go to the pen, let him keep going. I think in the 7th is when it fell apart, 5-3 final. His success on the road with the Pirates, I think he'll bounce back, give a good effort. Pirates kind of need a win. Whether you think their playoff positioning is really in threat at this point, I don't think so, but you can't slough off too much. So look for the Pirates with Liriano on the road. Decent number, not crazy, against Cincinnati. A team that can give you a decent game. Not going to say Cincinnati at home is a walkover, but it is a team you could get a road win against. And I think the Pirates kind of needing a win, get that. That's going to be your free play tonight, MLB Pirates minus 120. Would be remiss to not tell you guys, MLB best bet selections. It's almost embarrassing to say it is so good, but 19 wins, 3 losses the last 22 days. That's 86%, and it's been going strong. I'm really happy with it. Anybody's actually would be happy with it. Try to keep the subscribers going. College football has kind of slumped to start, 4-6 overall. 0 wins, 2 losses on the best bets. I've got my next best bet Thursday on the college football action. Really, really looking to get that first win under the belt with the best bets. That's Thursday night. But tonight, the MLB best bet is ready, it's played, it's fired. Everybody, subscribers have had it for a while. It's $29 a month, guys. It's going to be about $1 a day. You're going to get my playlist delivered to your play box daily. What I have might not be a lot every day of every month, but I'm going to try to build you into a winning format of a sustainable profit. I don't want you to feel like this needs to be a quick pot. I need to win pot. Let me hit win pot. We love to win. That's what the point of doing this is to win. But at a month, you give me a month, hopefully even if I have a few struggles, I can show you what the program is about. So that's why the $29 is for a 30-day month subscription. No sales pressure, no bullshit. I'm not going to hassle you. You guys know me. I'm not that kind of person. I'm just not going to play the game that way. This is serious handicapping, looking to find value in predicting winners the old-fashioned way. Got the pen, the paper, a stereo tape, me and Eric B. with a nice big plate of fish, which is my favorite dish. But without no money, it's still a wish. Now, I don't like to dream about getting paid, so I dig into the books of the rhymes that I made. I like to show my friends that I got pool. I hit the studio, cause I'm paid in full. Bum ba dum, bum ba dum, bum ba dum. Bum, bum. Excuse me for just completely going tangent with Eric B. and Rakim, paid in full. Just nuts. So that's tonight, MLB best bet. Locked and loaded, 19-3, 86%, guys. This service has been on fire. Overall, the MLB Best Bets is like the wheelbarrow carrying the winning tickets out the door. This isn't bullshit. I'm not going to book. If when I suck, I suck. When I'm winning, I'll mention to you that I'm winning. I'm not going to blow it out of proportion beyond what it is. 19-3 is pretty damn good for 22 days. And no matter how you evaluate handicapping, that's solid. I have taken some chalk. Of the 22 days, I've had two plays over 160. That's what I typically call my, and one was 160, one was minus 200. The 200 was actually one of the only three losers. So as you can see, that's why I seldom will play it. Most of them are in the 130. I'm going to say the average price of these 22 plays without actually doing the math is going to be in the low 120s, 122, 121, 120, in that range, overall average. Because I have had a underdog. I've used run lines for juice underdog. So, yeah, maybe even less. Maybe more like 117, 116, you know, on the average odds of the 22 plays. Solid value plays. I'm not just throwing out some minus 250 chalk and saying, here you go, guys, best bet. I'm giving you like a 130, a 120, a run line, even money, maybe a little better. Something that I'm looking for the setups and the pitchers. That's what I do. That's how I handicap baseball. I'm heavy pitchers. I'm here. Baseball's not all about pitching. During the grind of a regular season, baseball is a lot. It might not be all about pitching, but let me tell you something. If you don't have any, you're not winning shit, my man. You're just going down the fucking commode. You're going to get raped. You're going to win some games because you can out-hit teams from time to time. But without pitching, it's just a nice slow slide down the toilet, baby. You will not win. I view pitching as a prerequisite. Good pitching, prerequisite for a successful team. That's why I look for situations and setups with pitchers I consider reliable, or situations that I consider the best you can find are pitchers that are viewed dog shit by the public, which a lot of them are well deserved. Sometimes they're kind of just had a bad stretch, so they're not totally piles of shit in my eyes or the way I look at the numbers. But you look for those guys in situations where they've been pitching good on an uptick, and you catch them at a nice dog price. Had a couple of those. I had Jimenez against Toronto Friday. Came right back Saturday with Santana for the Twins on Saturday at a big price against Houston. And as soon as Houston won the game on the diving catch in the ninth inning, I knew immediately that Houston run line would be the best bet the next day because of the setup. I had the numbers kind of already factored in. And I say, if the Twins pull off this game, I cash this pick on my underdog. It's perfect setup. And that's the way it played out. And Houston won the next day 8-5 to cash the ticket. That's when you're zoned in and rolling. When I'm like a piece of chess, you know, a chess move, you move your pieces judiciously, but you can see ahead to see the move ahead. If I move it here and this goes, if I like the way this move goes, what would be the move behind it? And you start nailing those, you're zoned in. Service is zoned in, guys. So it's $29 a month, $1 a day. I want as many subscribers as I can. Honest, the money I bring in, I'm going to try to use mostly to advertise. And I'm really stingy with, like, I don't want to just piss money away on advertising that doesn't get people to come to listen and be part of the group that don't want to come and listen. I want people really serious about long term. If you enjoy sports and you gamble, that's the two questions I ask. Are you a sports fan? Do you gamble on sports? If those two things are yes, then I think invest in me. Look, 360 a year is what we're talking about, you know, for over the course of a full year. I can't guarantee anything, but I feel certain, even if the winning isn't to your liking for that, I'm willing to, you know, give you other service, the entertainment if necessary. I'll do a song and dance for you for a few bucks. But now it's all about us being that group, you know, 100, 1,000. It doesn't matter to me the size as long as it's people that are really intent on being part of the group. If you're here looking for the quick hit, the big score all the time, then you got the wrong guy. Because while I can provide those wins for you, I'm not going to blow smoke up your ass, and I can't always win. Nobody can. So I'm a long-term guy that is on a very nice winning long-term hot streak right now. It's been a good year on top of another good year on top of another good year on top of, you know, another good year. We can keep it going. I just want to be part of the group with you guys. So free play email list at the website, greatwhitecapper.com. You can go there, put your name, give me an email. You can also leave comments, suggestions, recommendations, things you'd like to hear about the show, things you don't like. Put that on there, send it to me. You'll get that free play email. When I do send them out, you'll be there because your name will be on the list. Boom, you don't have to wait for the podcast to hear it or to see it on a social site like Facebook or Twitter. Get on the list. Even if you don't want to subscribe right away, I would suggest getting on that list. Free plays have been doing pretty damn good. I put on one post this morning, you know, here's your free play today. I know these are hitting good, but believe it or not, the best bets are hitting even better. So check that out at the site. I'm going to get this podcast put together and out to you guys real quick. So looking overall today, big stories, Goodell in the NFL, a lot of things are going to be said about that coming down the next few days. We talked about the Williams sisters, what they have going on tonight. I'll be watching. I suggest, you know, for a moment in time, you know, to see it maybe for the last time, who knows, Serena and Venus in a Grand Slam tournament tonight, 4 p.m. out here on the West, 7 o'clock on the East Coast. Also, free play MLB tonight for you guys is going to be the Pittsburgh Pirates. We talked about the service. We talked about the NFL card coming up. I have the best bet solidified, ready to go. Subscribers have it. If you're a subscriber, you already know what the NFL top bet of the week is for week one. I'm going to ask for a little bit of help. I'm going to close this show. This is Al Stewart and his Year of the Cat. up three notches to number 9 this week. I'm Casey Kasem, and we're counting down the hits. All right, guys, you have a good night. Thanks for tuning in. We'll try to do this podcast again tomorrow. We'll have Al Stewart take me out, guys. I'll talk to you tomorrow. Good luck tonight. Listening to a production of thegreatwhitecapper.com.